When we look at Luther and mission, I want to include a very important aspect that is one's view of man and who he is. And my thesis is this, that Luther's anthropology is well worked through by him theologically, so that when you talk about him and the perspective he takes on who man is, it is only proper to be human being in a relationship with God, a relationship that has been restored through the act of justification. So that perspective that he takes on who man is, properly understood, is only to be defined theologically, soteriologically, meaning salvation that has come to man, restores him back into the relationship with God. Anybody living outside of that relationship is, in Luther's mind, not proper human. So with that, that limits our perspective of human somewhat outside of Christ. And question comes, who is he? And that one, if he does not believe in Christ as a human being, Luther does not answer that very well, because his purview, his scope, is somewhat narrowly defined. I want to see and understand only man through the act of how God justifies him and puts him in as a new man before God in Christ. His talk and his discussion on who man is being studied carefully. But we have to say, missiologically speaking, understanding who man is would imply that that restoration occurs to the proclamation of the Word of God to people. The restoration occurs through proclamation. So that is a missiological statement, really, because how can the person outside of Christianity come to restoration unless it occurs through the proclamation? Where does Luther get all this information from? Well, obviously Scripture, and also to some degree from Aristotle, you know, the old Greek position that man is a human being with a phronesis, with a reason, okay, and exists as a reasonable human being, able to manage his everyday life by using it. So we have something in common with people out there who are not Christians, but they are not in the restored relationship with God and don't respond accordingly to what God wants them to be. Remember how Luther closes every creed explanation to the, I shall, therefore God provides me with all the goodness, and I shall respond, serve, and obey him. That is kind of a conscious relationship that exists, and man needs to be understood in this, what I would call, a relational response-ability. Relational response-ability. That needs to be coming into a human being, the ability again to do that. And so that is Luther's understanding in a nutshell. And if we were to look at why he says it so harshly, is because revelation, God's revelation, gives us the final statement on who man is. No philosophy, nothing can do and take the place of God's revelation. And so when we look at other things, stories about who man is, we will obviously have those who want to go into the sciences, social sciences, and delve into them and see where can they say, hear more about God, about man. Neurosciences are very popular these days. Human behavior is programmed in your programmed in your mind, and all you do in terms of behavior is just a response to your brain functions. Okay. Doing this or grabbing this is already programmed. So you're basically determined. You're not as free as you think you are. And so then the cultural anthropology comes in, psychology and medical fields, you know, they all speak to man. But when they speak to man, they only can share or contribute a small little minuscule part on who man is, because revelation trumps it all. That's what comes from Scripture. A modern anthropologist, the first modern one who wants to bring also evolution into the discussion, is called Max Scheler, okay? He was known to be very famous, lived at the turn of the 19th century, actually the dates are 1874 to 1928, and he wrote a book called The Human Place in the Cosmos. The Human Place in the Cosmos. And he expressed his frustration that today, at his time, when he wrote this in the 1920s, was that there were so many or multiple observations on man, and none of them could unite over a common story on who man is. Let me quote to him. He says, "Ask an educated European today what his thoughts are when one uses the term human being, and he will just about always find three irreconcilable ideas about the term, which are in continuous conflict with each other. There is, first, the Jewish Christian tradition about Adam and Eve and of creation. Secondly, then, there's also the thought about man stemming from the ancient Greeks, which is that human beings have a consciousness of themselves and realize their special place through the possession of reason, phronesis, ratio. Closely connected with this view is the theory that there is also a reason above the human being that underlies the whole universe and with which the human being alone is in a state of participation. And then the third view, there is the thought of natural science and genetic psychology. Today already a tradition, according to this theory, the human being represents a late stage in the evolution of our planet. He distinguishes himself only by degrees of complexity of the energies and the abilities that he has inherited from ancestors in the animal world that are found in subhuman nature." Scheler looks at these three accounts here. The Jewish Christian tradition that goes to Adam and Eve and creation and draws some lessons out of that story. The narrative then that goes to the Aristotelian Greek tradition with highlighting reason. And the third is that evolution story about man. And so he says finally in his conclusion, "These three ideas lack any underlying unity which could provide us with a common foundation. Thus, we have a theological, philosophical, and a scientific anthropology before us, but which, as it were, have no concerns with each other, yet we do not have one uniform idea of the human being. The ever-growing number of special disciplines which deal with the human being conceal rather than reveal his nature, no matter how valuable the disciplines may be." All three studies are still prevalent today, we could argue, right? There is our Jewish Christian tradition. We talk about Adam and Eve and creation. Then there are the Darwinists, you know, the naturalists or materialists that speak about man also. And then the medical world that has a contribution to do as well, from psychology to medical things and neurosciences. We could say perhaps today there are more stories about man that make it even more complex about who he is than at the time when Scheler wrote this commentary here. If we ask Luther, how many perspectives did he grow up with that were taken on man? Well, you could probably say the multi-perspectives were not as prevalent during his time as they are today. And so evolution had not yet cropped up, right? So he didn't know that story either. But he was in some ways cognizant of various arts of sciences that would posit man differently or look at man from a different perspective. A lawyer looks, for example, at a man as probably a source of money. You know, says, this guy, you know, he has possessions and I need to defend him and I'll get something out of him, you know. A doctor looks at a human being from a medical doctor from the issue of well-being and disease and says, you know, this is kind of how I see man. And so he is aware of this, that there are various perspectives and are taught already at universities. But we are benefiting or not benefiting, we could say, from the Romantic Enlightenment era. And the Romantic Enlightenment era may reach its pivot at the time of Immanuel Kant. You Google a writing that he wrote, which is called What is Enlightenment? You just go read that. What is Enlightenment? And what basically formulated in 1784, Immanuel Kant says this: Enlightenment is man's emergence from a self-incurred immaturity. Immaturity is the inability to use one's own understanding without the guidance of another. This immaturity is self-incurred if its cause is not lack of understanding, but lack of resolution and courage to use it without the guidance of another. The motto of enlightenment is therefore sapere aude, that is to have courage to use your own understanding. In other words, what we are hearing here is the ultimate goal to be human is to be free from all outside authorities, to be free from God. And that's what the quest is for our society, really, is for man to be independent from outside authorities. Whereas to Luther, the only way you can exist as a human being is under the authority of God. That determines your existence. So it's taking it a totally different perspective as to how we should understand man than what here Kant has done. So obviously, pair that with Darwinism, you would say that man rose to the top by achieving these that status at the top through his own feet of using his reason and his abilities. Okay, and some fell to the wayside, left and right. So there are a number of theories that go along with this, how actually that happened. You know, I was in Ethiopia at the museum where Lucy is found. You know Lucy, that is the famous missing link, that is supposedly a tree dweller, but could also walk upright and kind of is the pre-stage just before Homo sapiens started, okay? Those of us are called Homo sapiens, the modern race. And she is touted, and just recently they've said that Lucy was a tree dweller, and the cause of her death was she fell from the tree, okay? Because the broken bones indicate this very thing. And if you were have a human fall from the tree, there would be similar fractures on the bone. So most theorists and scientists now say the Homo sapiens come from tree dwellers, okay? So you can get these, and those are theories, right? I mean, those are things which are put forward, and we kind of feel that we always have to follow suit with them. A theologian called Helmut Thielicke wrote a book, Being Human, Becoming Man. It's a good book to read for all of us. And he cites there Sigmund Freud and calls attention to three humblings that have occurred to humanity, three humblings. He says there, the first humbling of humanity is the cosmological one, where Copernicus was responsible when he showed that the earth and humanity are not the center of the universe. He forced upon us the startling insight that we are an insignificant marginal phenomenon, mere dust set on a particle of dust. So marginalizing us through Copernicus would say, you know what, you are no longer the center of the universe. You're an outside and orbiting around something. Don't think yourself to be at the center. The second humbling is biological. Biological comes from Darwin. Brought the second humbling when, with his theory of evolution, he demonstrated our animal ancestry. This seemed to demand the conclusion that we are no longer privileged as compared with the animal kingdom, that we no longer enjoy the prerogative of divine likeness, but that we have to regard ourselves as higher animals. And the third humbling then is the psychological one, which was from Sigmund Freud. Sigmund Freud put before us here the plain message that we are not under control of the self and its will, but we are a complex of subconscious impulses that we cannot control. Okay, so that's kind of where, you know, we could look at to see where human beings are studied and viewed. And in view of these developments, it seems almost that Luther has little to contribute to the discussion. However, in my personal research, and as I am writing a book, I finished it actually on this topic, have found that Luther's helpful position comes from his disputation of 1536 on this topic. 1536, that Disputatione Homine, and that wants to locate basically the discussion of man against and versus the contemporary philosophical discussions that the medieval scholastics had about man. You must realize who dictated their theology. That was predominantly Aristotelian fed, which meant that they always had to highlight the capacity in man of reason and will. Depending on which school you came from, modern, via moderna, or antiqua, which means, you know, if you were Gabriel Biel, you would probably go more with the will, or Occam, you know, whereas if you have if you go with Thomas Aquinas, it would be more the reason, okay? But both factored into the concept of salvation. So if you are saved, you will have to think about how is it impacting, or how's the will contributing towards this, or if you are saved by reason, how does reason factor into that as well? And so Luther takes issue with this. And when he wants to talk about it, he goes to the actual thesis itself and discusses a number of things here that are worth noticing, okay? You could also go to other writings that might be very important in this discussion. You could, for example, go to Luther's On the Bondage of the Will, right? If you read that, the Servo Arbitrio, that's a very famous and helpful writing to look at the free will and how that relates to the spiritual issues we have with relationship with God. You could look at his lectures of Genesis, where he talks about the cause of sin and the image of God and how the cause of sin in his way, Luther. You see, Calvin just understands the cause of sin as abridgment, you know, of a disobedience to the commandments, just a breaking of the law. Luther goes far deeper than that. He says it is what leads you to break the law. What leads you to break the law? That's so it's kind of going deep down into the heart of man and saying you are captive, held captive by concupiscence, the evil desire that is compelling you to do things against God's will. So, and then you have a number of other things like lecture on Galatians in 1531 or the sermon on 1 Corinthians 15, where it's important to look at how do you get restored in the good relationship with God, and that occurs in 1 Corinthians through the second Adam, through Christ. And so that is where Luther posits a restoration idea. And the Large Catechism of the Creed talks very much about a robust Trinity. That is, that as a true Christian living sees itself in every way embraced by the triune God. At creation, I've been created with my reason and all this, and he provides me daily. Then with my Redeemer, I live a daily life as well, and with the Holy Spirit, the Sanctifier as well. In all three realms, I am embraced by the Trinity. There is no zone where God is not part of my life. If we look at Luther's description on who man is, we would obviously think more about our systematic training that we had at the seminary and elsewhere, which is to think of four stages of who man is: the pre-fall man, the pre-fall man, the post-fall man, the man in God in the state of grace, and then man in the final stage here as well. These four stages will not be found in Luther in a systematic way. However, when you look at his disputation, you will see that he does highlight the pre-Adam stage, then he highlights how the state of corruption exists, then the state of grace, of restoration, and then the final one. In this perspective, the idea of destiny must come in. If there's one German word in anthropology you want to know, is Bestimmung. It means destiny. What is the destiny of man? And that is, of course, for Luther, Christologically defined. The destiny of man is to be with Christ and to be finally with Christ, therefore eschatologically as well. So when we talk about man in many other ways, which we can from Luther, there's lots of more we can talk about, namely on the first article, we touched it for the when we talked about the vocation of man, the first order of creation, and all this orders of creation. Those things must all come in and discuss how we talk about man. But I am now talking more about the Christologically defined human being to be destiny, to be restored in the new relationship with Christ. That is the central theme here that I'm looking at it. And when we see here the story that Luther offers, then he would say one thing that's important. In Psalm 51, he says, "What is the content of my theology?" Very simple, he says. My content of theology is this: the human being who stands under the guilt of sin and is lost, as well as the justifying God and Savior of this sinful being. Those are the two realms he talks about and says that must be the center of our theology, that man stands under the guilt of sin and is lost, as well as then the state where he is justified and restored. So the question of a merciful God, the idea that God is merciful, rests on the other pillar of our Lutheran theology that talks about the sinful man. And we've got to get that right in order to get the second one right also. If you don't get the sinful part in the discussion who man is in the fall, state of fall, then you will also get it wrong about how he's to be restored. If you talk about capacities like free will, reason, and you bring that into the relationship with Christ, you will start to think and detract some of the work that he has done. That is why Luther wrote the Disputation Concerning Man, to clear the clutter that has come into theology, that has destroyed the true cross and the understanding of Christ's status and the merits that are now being detracted from Christ. So, with that then, why don't we look at the disputation a little bit further here. The first slide that you have on there is a quote, okay? And he says clearly something that I want to bring to your attention there. And there he says, "Reason describes man," he says, "only as a mortal in relation to this life," thesis 3, "and gathers information on man only a posteriori," afterwards, "gained from observation and experience. Theology instead draws in additional factors a priori that precede, transcend, or go beyond what is observable and rationally verified. Philosophy cannot accept the a priori facts of man, and therefore can only produce a limited version on who man is. Theology tells the far greater story. For this reason, Luther's invective against philosophy makes sense. Therefore, if philosophy or reason itself is compared with theology, it will appear that we know almost nothing about man." I don't know how that impacts your pastoral ministry, your counseling of people, whether you know that in spite of their problems in marriage, their problems with their own psychological state, whether you see that, whether you are willing to relegate these issues to somebody in the secular realm who seems to have much better control of these disciplines. I would say we Lutherans never deny technology the right to help us humans to lead a better life. We are not like the first immigrant Lutherans who came to the state here and said, you know, we can't have lightning rods. Because if we have lightning rods, then we are interfering with God's providential care. You know, we can't take health insurance. Health insurance would also question God's care of you, right? You're looking for elsewhere. So these are a lot of things that the initial Lutherans, when they came, were somewhat skeptical of. You know, you can't just go and... It's almost Amish-like attitude. And we have embraced technology so much that we are willing to use it always. But when it comes to anthropology, we often have to ask, you know, is it all well what we use? You know, especially at the end-of-life issues. If you think about that, when you have somebody passing away or near death, but you try at all means to prolong life, you know, and guilt somebody into not using this or that treatment, rather than saying who dies this, that dies at home dies well, things like that. Also, in the beginnings of life, we have now the pre-implantation genetic manipulation or genetic editing. That means you can go to a gnome, you know, a pre fibrocyst, you know, which is not yet in the uterus, firmly implanted, and you can actually eradicate things that are detrimental to society. So if somebody has certain things, you know, characteristic, you know, my back hurts me, so I don't want my daughter to inherit this. So when I will see to it that that back pain gene or something is eradicated. It is seemingly so simple now that school children can start doing that in laboratories. So this is all something new that happens. But as Lutherans ethicists, we have to be careful that we don't allow this all to happen, because we are starting to think again like creating a master race that in some ways replicates the ideals that were during the Third Reich. And we need to learn from the lesson from that. I found actually our parish in Emmanuel Lutheran in Fort Wayne had did a huge renovation of its own church building and found in the sacristy a book by a German professor in Munich. And he had clearly written this book to support the idea of the genetic manipulation of people by underscoring the benefits of it, that namely, if you do it, you will have sooner or later this person looking this way rather than as he currently looks, and validating, therefore, that one should start looking about not supporting the ill and the sick, you know, in society, but rather let them be set aside so that for the welfare of society in the future. And you see how that thinking goes. It can go into a bad direction and cause a lot of things that will no longer take our createdness as we are into consideration. That is just a parenthetical talk here. But we're coming back to Luther. Luther explains here philosophy critically. He says to philosophy, you know only things a posteriori. Do you know what that means? It's things that are being talked about by virtue of the observation having been made empirically. So when philosophers and doctors talk about man, they base all their observations about and descriptions of man from those that have been made and studied. Whereas Luther says a priori, that's theology now, because theology goes and says there is a story about you even before you existed. And that story is about your creation, about God, about Christ and your restoration. That story needs to be told too. That may not be empirically verifiable, but it is nonetheless something revealed to us from God and therefore has a huge authority. he goes into something that perhaps is somewhat contrived, but I don't want to keep it away from you. Luther explains his critical position against the prevalent social sciences. I would include all of them in philosophy from the four causes talk, okay? Now, you might not know what the four causes are, but they are very prevalent in anything, applied to anything that exists, okay? So if you, for example, have a statue, Remington, you know, of a Bronco rider, you know that, right? You would say, apply the four causes to it, and you would say, okay, what is the efficient cause? In other words, what brought about the Remington steel? Who is its creator? Efficient cause. It would be the sculptor or whoever that is, plus the knowledge, you know, that is replicated by this apprentice and so forth. And then you would have the final cause. Why would it be made even? Who makes a Remington? What for, do you think? To decorate, adorn someone's office? Probably a Texan millionaire or something. I don't know. And then, yeah, they are about $600, you know, so it's not something you can just go and buy, you know, especially us pastors, right? And so that's the final cause for what it's being designed. Then you would have to say the formal cause is, okay, now looking at it, what shape does it have? It has a shape of a horse and a man sitting on top of it. So that's the formal cause. That's the shape it has. And a human being in that sense would be an upright walking person. Then you ask the material one, the causa materialis. What is it made of? And obviously we would say that a Remington is made out of bronze, okay? So now you have four causes, and materially speaking, Luther would say, we know that man exists of body, meat, of flesh, and soul. So in that regard, we would have to think about man as a dual being, you know, soul and body. And he says, if you look at philosophy now, asking these four questions there, he says he does not think that they know the efficient cause. He says, you don't know. You social scientists, you people out there, you don't want to bring God into the question because he's not verifiable. In other words, you can't empirically prove God. And so you will say, I will not take them into my observation about who man is. So they talk, they don't know the efficient cause. So, thirdly, they don't know the final cause, the destiny of man. Because the true the destiny of those who support philosophy and sciences will always say the destiny of man is perhaps happiness and wealth in this world. That's at best what you get. So the final destiny for Luther is, of course, to be with God, to be justified and to be with God. So he has clearly a solution to that question as well. At best, they can speak perhaps of the formal cause, that man is an upright walking being, and the material cause that he has actually a body. But some would even today obviously be monistically inclined, which would say man exists as flesh only, and when he dies, that's what it is. There's no soul at all. But then you get into a problem of explaining personality. How do you explain personality if everything is flesh? That means all our character, our anger, and these things are explained chemically. And I don't know whether that quite... And what about spiritual beings? What about understanding us being religious and attuned to something higher? That cannot be explained merely by virtue of us being of flesh and blood. So theological solution then, he says. Namely, theology in Thesis 21. My solution, Luther then says, is in Thesis 21, namely that man is a creature of God consisting of body and a living soul, made in the beginning after the image of God, without sin, so that he should procreate and rule over the created things and never die. So Luther talks about made in the image of God, without sin. So there was a state of pristine existence. We don't know exactly how sin came about, you know. That's one of the few theological questions that are considered open, you know. I come from the Missouri Synod. There's never an open question to theology. It's all clearly defined, you know. Make no mistake on that one. But here we have kind of the how did sin come about, you know, is really, it's just, it came, okay? 2:22 then. But after the fall of Adam, certainly he was subject to the power of the devil, sin and death, and a twofold evil of for his powers, unconquerable and eternal. So Luther describes two states there, the one that is in the state of original righteousness, and then in thesis 22, the fall. He then goes on to 23, the solution. He can only be freed and given eternal life through the Son of God, Jesus Christ, if he believes him. So Luther interprets here the image Christologically, teleologically, eschatologically. I'm talking about this from a missiological point of view. There's, for example, Alan Hirsch. Alan Hirsch is a famous missiologist who writes book after book. And he talks, we must go out and serve the community because they are all created in the image of God. I stumbled on that statement. And then I read another one by Georg Wietzedom, who says, no, we go out into the community and reach out to them in order that they may be restored in the image of God. So what is what here now? Huh? That's the question also. I'm almost thinking if everybody has the image of God already, then we don't need to do mission work. Okay? And so that kind of comes into the discussion as well. If we continue Luther's solution here on thesis 26, therefore, those who say that natural things have remained untainted after the fall, a philosopher philosophize impiously in opposition to theology. 27. The same is true of those who say that a man, in doing what is in him, is able to merit the grace of God in life. What is in him? This is a very important phrase that Luther confronted, because at his time, the idea of sin and grace were prevalent. But do you know how it is constructed? It's constructed around this idea. God is gracious, but he responds only those who are willing. That means that God responds to something that is in man. Okay? He has the freedom to respond, but he will respond to those that are willing. And that willingness is to do as much as possible as you can. And Luther followed suit, didn't he? He went to the monastery and then tried to do as much as possible in himself as possible. But what occurred is really this, that it backfired on him, because he realized whatever he did, is it enough? Okay? And so will God's mercy kick in? In other words, will God then give his mercy that 99% or 90%? So there was this kind of insecurity in his whole being in the state of monastery life, not quite sure how he should factor in his own contribution and how much will that influence God. So there was a restlessness in his theology, a restlessness in his whole being, because it was taking a more anthropocentric perspective on who man is and trying to influence God's act on him. So also the same is thesis 28. So also of those who introduce Aristotle, who knows nothing of theological man, to witness that reason aspires to do the best thing, to the best things. 29. Also those who say that the light of God's countenance is in man as an imprint on us, that is a free will which forms the precept right and the will of good. In other words, what we have in Luther's time was the kind of the idea that you fall into sin, yes, but the natural capacities of man are not blemished. They are not broken. Only the additional grace, donum super additum, you know, that's the grace that God then gives to man additionally, will come to him. But there are still in man, after the fall, the natural capacities. All he does not have is this additional gift of grace. So these natural capacities then became important, the free will, the reason, brought to the table in what it means to be saved. And then Thesis 20, 30, in like manner that it rests with man to choose good and evil or life and death, etc. So Luther then comes in two theses that I want to just mention as well. On the last slide here, justification. Paul in Romans 3:28, we hold that a man is justified by faith apart from works. He briefly sums up the definition of man, saying, man is justified by faith. 33, certainly, whoever says that a man must be justified says that he is a transgressor and unjust, and thus asserts that he is guilty before God, but must be saved by grace. So, when we take these theses that Luther has put before us, okay, and I'm not quite done yet, because he then talks about the Christological restoration of the image in Thesis 34 following. And that is there that he takes man, Thesis 34, in general, that is universally so that he consigned to the whole world or whatever is called man to sin. Therefore, man in this life is the simple material of God for the form of his future life. Just as the whole creation, which is now subject to vanity, is for God the material for its future glorious form. And as earth and heaven were in the beginning for the form completed after 6 days, that is its material, so is man in this life for the future form when the image of God is being remolded and perfected, right? So Luther, I would say, looks forward. Man is to become something. He is, we call that teleological, with a destiny in mind, and that is Christologically defined. He comes also to the structure of man and says, namely in Thesis 21, that man is a creature of God consisting of body and a living soul. Luther ends up being a dichotomist, you know, which means basically he understands man to be of body and soul, and spirit, you must understand, comes in as well. Some are trichotomists, say spirit is a third component. Luther would say there is one spirit in man that is big S, the Holy Spirit, okay? But there is also the small S, the evil spirit. So he sees body and soul being taken advantage of negatively and positively, and that's why the spiritual battle ensues. Sinner and saint is played out then. Okay? Thesis 39. Meanwhile, man lives in sin and daily is either justified or becomes more polluted. Romans 7. Was there a and this is where Luther comes in with the understanding of Romans 7, supporting himself on the basis of Paul's own definition of who he is. Now, you could say, is Luther interpreting Paul correctly? Is Paul Luther not putting on Paul a Luther? A Luther stunt, if you will. In other words, was there a Paul before Luther? And some scholars have now emerged. Actually, it's not that new. It's often associated with a new perspective by Wright and others, N.T. Wright, who nowadays say Paul is not the Paul that as Luther describes him to be. Okay? Paul is far more positive on the law. He doesn't speak of it in its accusatory function as Luther wants it to be. Luther is just pushing on Paul a kind of obsession with sin that Luther had for himself and psychologically never overcame it. Paul is more into the freedom idea, freed up. So when you talk about scholars, the New Perspective and others, they hold that Paul is talking about his pre-conversion days. When Paul says that I am a sinner and I do and I live after my flesh and do what I should not be doing and do not what I should be doing, then Paul is talking about his pre-baptismal life. And Luther himself said, no, Paul is talking about himself after baptism, after his justification, because we still believe in a sinner and saint tension that really brings out this very important point that we are not free of sin as long as we live here on earth and always battle with it. So, in other words, do we ever overcome sin in such a way that we can prevent it from happening in our life? Is there not a spiritual growth possible? Luther would say that, yes, there is. I can daily grow, he says in the Large Catechism. But, you know, he falls back into this idea, you can't grow very much. The growth that you go is more like, you know, like a carousel, not like so, you know. And so he falls back into this idea that we as Christians constantly battle. We might avoid this or that grave mortal sin, but we are nonetheless always infested, embedded in it, so that we are living out a life under God's forgiveness all the time. And I just want to bring that point out, that we need to understand Luther in this way correctly. What does sanctification mean? When we talk about sanctification generally, we talk of it this way. Okay, I've been justified by God. It's all His doing. Now that I've been justified, surely it's my turn. So sanctification becomes my turn now to do something for God. So it's kind of like understanding our existence in contractual terms. God, you do something for me, and then in sanctification, I will respond and do something for you. If we understand sanctification this way, we forget that we are always under guidance of the Holy Spirit, even at the time when we do good works. So in essence, when we talk of good works, we really are talking the product of the Holy Spirit through us, not our own product. You cannot love unless you are loved. And so you produce love only on the basis of it having been embedded in that love first before you can express it. So I think where we concentrate on is the absolution of our sins, forgiveness. We don't speak of demonstration of holiness anthropocentrically. What we mean by sanctification is really killing the old Adam, that he may daily, as the thesis one says, daily repent and kill the old Adam. One of the very points that intrigued me a lot here is the image of God, okay? I have there the thesis and then 22 again and 21, made in the beginning after the image of God. If we look at thesis 22, but after the fall of Adam, he was subject to the power of the devil, sin, and death, a twofold evil force, powers unconquerable and eternal. And he can only be freed, given eternal life through the Son, Jesus Christ. So what we are looking at here is that the image of God, really, in Luther, is that Adam, after the fall, can no longer be said to have the image. Before the fall, in the lectures, it is positively given to Adam and Eve. Though Adam is part of the animal kingdom, he and Eve were created in the image that elevates them above all other animals. However, when it comes to the image of God in all humans, Luther looks forward eschatologically to the future for its restoration. In his commentary on 1 Corinthians 15, verse 49, in reference to the second Adam, Luther looks forward to the celestial realm where the image will be fully restored in Christ. Therefore, he says, in external aspects, there was no observable difference between them and us. Later, however, we shall divest ourselves of that image and essence and receive another's, namely the celestial Christ. Then we shall have the same form and essence which he has now since his resurrection. Then we need no longer eat, drink, sleep, walk, stand, but will live without any creatural necessities. The entire body will be as pure and bright as the sun and as light as the air, and finally so healthy, so blissful, and filled with such heavenly eternal joy in God that it will never hunger, thirst, grow weary, or decline, basically like Adam lived at the time of creation before the fall. In his discussion on the image of God, Luther does not follow the contemporary interpretation of image and likeness, similitudo, and also eikon. In the one sense, similitudo was understood since Irenaeus that you have two understandings of the image, because God said, let us create man in my likeness, in the image of God. So there are two words being used, okay? And one is demut, and the other one is zelem. And the church has always divided up the image into two, saying the one is more the formal structure of man, which is kind of his being as a human, the zelem, more the personality and all that, whereas the demut is that likeness he has with God, the material substance, the righteousness and all this. And ever since Irenaeus, the church has followed this of speaking about an image in the broad and the narrow sense. The broad and narrow sense. On the one hand, the formal structure remains and is still there, but the material similitudo, that righteousness is no longer there, it is all lost. So, the medieval times talked about it too as the formal still existing, but the danger is there, they filled it up with the will and the rational capacities of man, and thereby man had an image that was strong enough still to be used in soteriology, that man could also conduct his and use his powers then. So Luther looks at that very importantly and says, no, the image of God is one. Okay, and that he bases on reference on Genesis 1:27, because the Lord God says there that the Hebrew text talks only about the imago Dei, the image of God in one sense, and we don't divide it up into broad and narrow sense. So when we talk about Luther understanding the image of God to be repaired in Jesus Christ, it means that before that repair, they have no image anymore. The idea of the image of God as one to be received in the future is to be understood in the context of a relationship with God established through Christ and faith in him. It makes the value of life for humans lie more in their destiny and in their purpose than being looked at from their creation. Helmut Thielicke follows Luther's depiction and says that the eschatological restoration is important, rather than go and try to reclaim something from creation. Not the whence, but the whither is what matters here. And so I quote him here, the certainty of the divine likeness is thus grounded in our final relationship and what we call our alien dignity. If we base our dignity on our biological origin, we are simply made to be more highly organized animals. If we base it on our immanent value and our functional abilities, we are sacrificed to animality. For when we lose our usefulness, we lose our right to life. Only that relation establishes the inviolability of our humanity. Only the fact that we are the children of God, the apple of his eye, bought with a price. So, when we look at Thielicke, he follows Luther and dismisses a regress to creation. His position reflects the idea, Thielicke's, that human dignity is to be restored in Jesus Christ, and he speaks out against any form of Darwinism that might influence our understanding of who man is by going back and saying we come from this and this and that, and we may be able to work on this, manipulate man. But rather we should say the image should be seen as a relationship we have with Christ again. Now this is interesting here to talk about human relationships as the essence of man. It's actually quite significant here that the Lord God says, I shall create Adam, but then I will also create him a partner. So in this sense, then, it is not good that man is alone. So it seems that the quintessence of humanity is relationships. The thing is just that, you know, we start off on an individual basis, right? You and I need to be justified. But when you are justified, yourself needs to forget itself. And you move on to the neighbor. Love your neighbor. Motivation. You remember what we said in lectures 1 and 2. So when we talk about this, Karl Barth goes even a step further. He says the image of God is really established or most clear in the relationship of husband and wife. In the image of God, we shall create them in the image of man and wife, right? So he takes this that way. We don't follow that. As Lutherans, we don't follow Karl Barth on that plane. But we do have also a kind of a tradition that talks much of the image in the broad sense, later dicta, in the secondary sense, which, however, does not include the distinction of sexes. Quinstedt and others in our theology quote Genesis 9 and 6, James 3, 9, where man is still being described after the fall in possession of the image, and therefore say there is still something of a broader sense of an image that speaks to the intellect and the will of man, and they will have in that sense still some resemblance with God. But the narrow image still needs to come along as well. So the image of God, when we talk about it here, goes against a tradition. And that is Luther goes back against the tradition that talks about an analogy of being. You see, what has happened in the theology always is, should we as human beings compare ourselves with God? In other words, when God says, let's create man in our likeness, are we God? We are not God, okay? But do we have some resemblance with God? And then some would say, yes, we have. God has ultimate reason, we have a little reason. God has the ultimate will, we have the will. Okay, God is this, we have this. So you start comparing yourself with God and you make certain analogies so that what God has in the ultimate sense, you also have. Luther says, get rid of that kind of thinking. Okay, what you need to go with is the relationship with Christ, that is the word encounter, where you come into a connection with the word and you are being put in connection with it. So it is accidental, not substantive. If you make any discussions on this, you would have to say the image of God rests in the soul. It is given to human beings accidentally that they possess it, but they only possess it as a gift from God in their possession as long as they believe. The only true image that runs around with it substantively is Jesus Christ. Okay, he's the true physical image, and then when we appropriate him, we get him, but we are in Christ only insofar as we are believing in him, so it's accidental. It comes from this idea, you see, the Roman Catholic have the Lord's Supper defined along these terms as well. When you start talking about real presence in the Roman Catholic sense, what do they say? They say bread and wine become body and blood of Christ, and only in their outer appearance still look like bread and wine, but they're not really bread and wine anymore. We Lutherans say in, with, and under, above and beyond, and in, and you know, whatever. We like these prepositions, don't they? In, with, and under. And so to us it's important that we say, not a local inclusion, it's not like held captive, but in and with bread you get the body, but it's still both entities there, not changed into a third. like honey and mead or something, and with water. So that's the idea here. And so when we talk about this, it's we are receiving an image of Christ as long as we walk in earth here as a gift. And it is the righteousness and holiness and true knowledge that is restored, that has been taken away through the fall. And Christ gives it to us, okay? So when we talk about image of God, we have to be very careful. Substantive asks the question, what is it? And we should say, be careful with that. What if you ask, what is it, and is it in possession of man? Then you will have to either say it is a capacity that man possesses. And then when you talk about that, you ask, well, what capacity is it? Can you define that for me? And then the danger is we start to categorize human beings. Say, no, the image of God is understood as rationality. Then who displays best rationality? Okay, then you would ask, well, this person doesn't, so he's lesser of a human being than I am. So the danger is you start to categorize human beings. It is also not regency, what one does. You see, in many terms, Old Testament scholars have a tendency to say that people have the image of God in terms of ruling the world. That's kind of the idea here. It's embedded in the regency. Be rulers of this world and make it serve you. And so the image is associated with that, just like an emperor, or in the ancient East, Egypt and Mesopotamia, there were kings that were representing God. Okay, and so also humans represent God then as well, in terms of the image. It's not that. Neither these approaches of either what it is or what you can do would satisfy Christian ethicists today. We cannot start, it makes us susceptible to categorize humans and disqualify some. Therefore, Luther blends into Genesis 1 Corinthians 15:49, so that God treasures every life in view of the true purpose and destiny in Christ. Outside of the relationship with Christ, Luther is reluctant to speak positively about man. So if I were to draw an image here, this is kind of his way, how he orientates it. Christologically, eschatologically, he looks forward from the fall and he goes towards its destiny being found in Jesus Christ. The alternative would be going back to Adam and trying to reclaim something that's there. Okay? And try and say there's some substance that's still with us humans today. Luther would say, I'd rather go forward and say that in Christ we are given everything. So, if we talk about the image in the broad and narrow sense, theologians still want to speak in the broad sense because they're afraid we are losing sight of human beings being valuable if we only start to talk about it Christologically. Oswald Bayer makes a quote there on that slide. I just want to quote. Accordingly, being in the image of God is not completely lost, but it is radically corrupt. It behaves like a radio receiver which still functions but picks up the wrong station. The community of communication is disrupted. The human can no longer hear or know God, even if he wants to. It only picks up static. Aha, so what does this capacity mean? In other words, man has still something there that God connects to, but it has to be connected, but God has to reenact it. Okay? So when we talk about capacity, Luther also says something like this: man is a subject which suffers passively, but has a passive capacity that is existing in man. You see, I have to think about it this way. Humans are not animals in the sense of conversion. God does not convert a horse or a cow or a dog, right? He only converts humans. So, is there not in man something that God connects to that is different to make than horse? But I don't know what that passive capacity is. It's just there. Okay, let's say we all have radio receivers in the broad sense. We all are radio receivers, but our station is right off dysfunctional. We pick up the wrong static messages. And so God has to come in and connect. But Luther never calls attention to a broad image like Bayer does and says, no, that's what all humans still have. Another theologian quite popular is Emil Brunner, who says, man has the capacity for words. In other words, he can speak, but God puts in man the ability again to respond and speak. The capacity is not an inherent power that he brings to the table. It is one that that God connects to, Anknüpfungspunkt in German. That elicited the huge Barth-Brunner debate, where Barth just wrote one book, nine, title, No, Man Does Not Connect. God connects to, if God has to connect to something outside of him, then that limits his sovereignty and power. I'm more with Brunner. I would agree that humans have a capacity, a capacity that is passive. And whether you want to now call that an image, that's a different thing. But that's certainly one we need to know. So in conclusion, Luther engages sciences, but points out their shortcomings. I think that's been clear. Luther affirms man is God's creation, and he is not relegated to particles of dust. Every aspect of his life is placed under God's care, the robust Trinity understanding. Man is thereby also responsory, eccentric, and should be. He should respond to God's act on him, spiritually, the Spirit, the creation, providing goodness, and the Redeemer. In both three ways, we respond with a thank you. Luther presents a narrative anthropology. Man's destiny begins at his creation and ends in eschatology. It peaks Christologically, the real image into which man is molded through justification. That is missiologically important. Only in the gospel, in the word of God, are we restored into the new relationship with God. However, as we are being restored, we also battle with sin as a reality. A final comment just by somebody. Blaise Pascal was a Jansenist, a contradiction in the Roman Catholic Church, more Lutheran than Roman Catholic almost, okay? But at any rate, he wrote this Penzies. These are always quoted here when one talks about who man is, and this kind of struck me, this little statement he makes. On this point, therefore, we condemn those who live without thought of the ultimate end of life, who let themselves be guided by their own inclinations and their own pleasures without reflection and without concern, and as if they could annihilate eternity by turning away their thought from it, think only of making themselves happy for the moment. True destiny is found, missiologically speaking, in the return into the image of Christ. And that's why we go to Chad, and that's why we go to other places around the world. Okay, thank you for listening. If you have any questions, I think we have a few left, a few minutes also from the previous presentation. As you remember, we were talking there about Luther, the Jewish question, and other things. So if you have anything to raise, you're welcome to do so. Yes, please.
I was wondering about Gerhard and Luther. Did they have similar views regarding
this? Gerhard talks of a broad image still extant in man, the ability to use one's reason. I have said that's ethically dangerous to talk about that, because if you say man uses his reason, then a student who is not as clever is perhaps relegated as being inferior to a student who is. So I would say, ethically speaking, it bears its own danger.
I'm just wondering if you would address this. In the last session, you made comments that really resonated with me that dealt with how we see our neighbor, that evangelism is rooted in love for the neighbor, and that love for the neighbor sees the neighbor not just as a target for some evangelistic outreach, but sees them as more than that, not just that they would get answers right to our questions at their door. And then in this session, now talking about the image of God, the only way to restore any kind of sense of the image of God is in their ultimate capacity to be reconciled to God. It seems that the one thing it invites us to see human beings as more than just somebody that ought to be reconciled, and I better get on that and help them through that process. And this one suggests that the image here is that if the image of God is to be restored, that's only found in that restoration with God through Jesus Christ. Is there a rub there? Is there a conflict there between those concepts?
That's a good observation. I don't know whether you feel that same way, but there's a little bit of a dissonance, here, which I have to agree on. The thing is, of course, what I meant by the first session, the session before, was that man needs to be understood holistically, body and soul. We cannot just walk over the bodies and go for their soul, so to speak. You know what I mean? So we have, in missionary terms, to see the dual mandate, so to speak. We take care for people's spiritual life, but we also take care for their physical life and condition. And as you all know, one striking difference to our life in the United States overseas is poverty. And we have to think and see about human beings as someone who is living under abject conditions that need to be helped. So I cannot just go to the jugular, as you will, and say, shove Christ down their throat, if you will. I'm sorry to use that term, but kind of that. That used to be somewhat a very strong Hudson Taylor orientation, though the faith tradition mission, which very strong, lived in eschatological terms, perspectives and thought, the end's coming now and we have to get onto conversion as quickly as possible. So yes, I do see that. However, I take in this discussion, Dietrich Bonhoeffer and Martin Buber often come up here, which means that as I help somebody, I see in the thou the I kind of idea, a switch of relations, of persons. The thou becomes the I. I see myself in the need of that person, and I replace myself in his position. And I look at him as a child loved by God, but to be restored. So I take my perspective of him as somebody who is loved by God, for whom Christ has died, to be restored in that relationship. Doesn't diminish my interest for that human or treat him negatively, but one who is teleologically defined. He is to be restored in God. Now, of course, I can say a little bit more. Perhaps this will still be inadequate for you. What about children, that are aborted? Well, why, if they are to be restored in Christ, my argument would say don't abort children, because they are destined to be in Christ, right? So don't do that. That could be one argument, like Tielicke does, from the wither. That's kind of how we look at humans. But I could just say, and Bonhoeffer does this and probably comes the closest to it, what you are concerned here, is just to say, whatever is born of human is human. We won't, a pregnant woman won't give birth to an elephant. So we know that. So it's human. So whatever is born human is human, and we should just leave it at that. Maybe that would be the best way to say it, rather than looking at all kinds of various perspectives on image, maybe, and fall into the understanding of they don't have it, and that's why they're inferior. But we are looking at this also from a spiritual condition. The spiritual condition is one that prevailed in Luther's theology. How is man to be understood in relationship to God? Not as just as a human being, but in a relationship. And if that's gone, then he had this real problem soteriologically. Well, who we are is not a biological, genetical definition. Who we are is defined spiritually and in a relationship. So that allows us also to say every human being is treated equally, because we don't want to go into the biological definition of one being better than the other, or denying our just the way we came on earth, you know. So I think it is a slippery slope. I have no answer to that question, 100%. It can serve our benefit, but it can also really create a lot of tensions amongst humans against turning against one another. For who decides, who makes the decision in the end that we as humans need to be genetically edited? Maybe the President of the United States? Huh? Then suddenly, then we are all still getting worried a little bit, you know. Arnold Schwarzenegger will be happy because his genes will be treated like God, you know. But what about ours here? So, and our children. So there is an unsettling factor here, and we have the pre-implantation diagnostic of trying to find out what the child is in the condition before it's born is helpful, but you also must realize it's not helpful, because many will take pregnancy conditionally only. In view of what the state of the fetus is, I might actually bring it to birth. If not, I'll abort it. So that can create all these various issues. But I have no answer to that yet. It will help us, but I kind of see it like the Lufthansa airline. I don't want to see it like the Lufthansa airline, because they do say a pilot at a certain stage during the flight is not in control of the plane because the computer will override him. Do we want to reach a stage, a post-human stage, where there are things walking around that dictate us? That might someday be the case, because if we see it in existential existential terms here, evolutionary existential terms, many people would say we are on top of the food chain, but not for long, right? And we say we have the status given by God, not by some evolutionary development. Yes.
Would you comment on... We had a conversation out here about the last session just mm-hmm. a little bit ago, and so just a quick context to that. From personal experience, when you characterize Billy Graham's ministry, mm-hmm. In 35 years I've had extensive involvement with him as a pastor of a church and leading the people mm-hmm. in a year-long process of relational evangelism, and then just a quick preaching service, obviously, that he does. Mm-hmm. My experience was that he was quite good at preaching sin and grace, law and gospel, but obviously one of the controversies is the altar call and so on. But what we saw and experienced, and I have, and the latest one was in 2005 in New York City. We saw people come to faith and into our church, and I personally counseled with people and so on. So I've been extensively involved across the country, different crusades in 35 years. The point being, it seems that what I sense happens is in the preaching service, he preaches pretty much sin grace from what I could tell. I believe faith was coming into the hearts of those as he preached. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, we had a chance to pray with those people, proclaim forgiveness to them, assure them. Or in a lot of cases, it was just some spiritual need they wanted to be prayed with about, and we prayed with that spiritual need. And again, we saw people come into church and so on that were truly saved. So my experience of that ministry was a little different than how you had characterized it. But if you would you like to respond to that?
Well, you know, I am no expert on Billy Graham. I've said that I've advised a student in the PhD program. I've been down in Charlotte and have experienced some firsthand Billy Graham people, supporters of his theology. Maybe we should say this. Does God justify someone who says yes? Does God justify someone who has faith, or does he justify him in order that he has faith? There might be a little difference there. In my mind, you have to say yes first, and then God will give you the grace, you know. Whereas in Lutheranism, we say God gives you the grace, and then you say yes. The response is a consequence of him working on you. It's already placed in ethics, the response. So it's not contingent on man doing it. I don't know how much I'm hitting on Billy Graham now, you know, so I will be willing to be corrected on this. I had also given, the student also had, as a non-Lutheran, you know, so he goes at it objectively, looked at Billy Graham's sermons that he preached in Charlotte. I think there was a series of six or seven sermons that he preached in the 60s. And he investigated clearly the theology under the title of the dissertation, How Evangelical is the Evangelist Billy Graham? I said, go for it. I don't know much about this, but you investigate. And so he says the evangelist Billy Graham is not evangelical, which means this, that Billy Graham talks a lot about sin and grace. He talks a lot about Christ really well, and make no doubt about it. But he cannot deliver the absolution from the pulpit. He cannot say, your sins are forgiven. He cannot do it unconditionally. It has to be conditional. Your sins will be forgiven. So when will they be forgiven is the question. When the person comes back to church or when he has said yes. So that's kind of where I'm hitting kind of the difference. There might be it's a slight little approach here. They will come from the sermon to the church and be nurtured by you and taught and all this. So it comes basically through the word too. Definitely, I don't want to diminish that. But it is making it kind of... if you have a son walking with him along the road and it's very slippery, would you have your son want to hold your hand or do you want to hold the son's hand? Yeah, so in other words, we say God grabs your hand, you don't grab God's hand. There's use another term, you see the Vishnuites, I believe, those that are coming from India, you know, you have the Brahman, Vishnuites, and what's the third god? Vishnu, Shiva, you know, and so... the Vishnuites who adhere to the god Vishnu have kind of a concept of grace in contrast to the rest of the Hinduism, which is kind of, just bear with me here, the difference between cat and monkey. How is a monkey being carried, a baby monkey? He's almost not carried. He clings to the mother, okay? And they say, that's not us when it comes to our relationship with God. How is a cat kitten being carried by the neck? And they say, that is what we have in terms of our theology. And now, apply that to our faith. What would you rather be, a monkey or described as a monkey theology or cat theology? You see, so it's a difficult term, and it's not sophistry. It kind of comes down to this notion that, as I've said with Peter Brunner and faith, in what way and to what degree does God connect to something in us humans? And does he really connect already to a human that responds, or does he create that response? That's maybe a difference there too. But you know, I'm open to correction. You know, so but I thank you for that. That does not. We are ecumenically here minded, so we take great respect for what he does and how many people he has influenced in Christ and brought them to faith. And it's been you know, something that we kind of miss in our society today. Some replacement of him and his preaching. Well, Luther does not want to get into the biological, ontological side, who we are with chromosomes and put together and all that stuff. I mean, he was very much out of that medical world that we have today, describing man, you know, as a pre-born human being. At that time, you know, the idea of quickening prevailed, which was at the stage where a child kicks, that's where you no longer may abort. You know, because that's when the Holy Spirit comes into somebody. You know, and so life was somewhat differently understood during his time. And could be said, I'm valued in view of that, what God is planning with me in Christ, or something like that. But, you know, now that you say it, I probably will have to investigate that very point. So thank you. Thank you for that.